Hi everyone, welcome to Ronin Expo. This is the first interview of this convention. With me, I have a very special guest. He's responsible for directing the highly acclaimed Mushishi series alongside Detroit Metal City, The Flowers of Evil, and a few Hatsune Miku videos including Downloader and Chime. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Hiroshi Nagahama.
Hi. Nagahama Hiroshi desu. Yoroshiku onegaishimasu.
Hi everyone, my name is Hiroshi Nagahama. Nice to meet you.
So let's start off with the topic of Mushishi. The world of Mushishi is a mystical and magical world. Was it a challenge to bring to life all the themes that Yuki Urushimura, Shirobara, sorry, presented in the manga onto the series?
原作の方もあるんですが、やっぱりそのムシシの世界、そのマジカルな世界、魔法の世界をアニメに作るときに大変だったのか。
そうですね。やってる最中は大変だとは全く思わなかったです。
When he was doing it, he didn't feel that it was hard, tough at all. He didn't feel like it was really a hard process.
ウルシバラユキさんの漫画がもう原作の漫画がものすごく面白かったので、これをそのまんま作れば絶対成功すると思って作りました。
And he said that he felt that Mushibara Yuki-san's manga, reading it, he just thought it was so well done, and he just thought it was so interesting. And he said, if I make it true to this, then it should be a great anime.
Now, moving on to Detroit Metal City, there were a lot of profanities and obscene visuals in that anime, although it was comedic. What were your initial thoughts on Detroit Metal City when you were presented with it?
そのデトロイトメタルシティのことなんですが、コメディなんだけど、一応そういろんな、ね、悪い言葉とか、ちょっとすごいシーンがいっぱい入ってるんですけれども、それを作るときにどういう考え方でアプローチしてたのか。
もう徹底的に、あれはギャグ漫画が原作だったので、ギャグです。もう徹底的にやる、もう漫画よりももっとひどく、もっと汚くとか、
もっともっとプッシュする。
そうですね、ものすごくこう乗っけて乗っけてやってったって感じですね。
He said that even the original manga is like that already. So when he was making it, he was like, he wanted to make the gags even more extreme. So he's like, let's just put more and more and more, like pile it on. And that's what he thought when he was making that.
We've mentioned two series that have become live action movies, Mushishi and Metal Detroit City.Do you feel that these live-action movies did a great job portraying the source material? The material source, sorry.
あと、ムシシとその、デトロイト・メタル・シティの方もライブアクションの映画になりました。やっぱりそういうアニメからライブアクションに作るっていうのは結構大変なところもすごいあったりしてると思うんですが、その実際にライブアクションになったものっていうのは、いい作りでできたのか、またはちょっと満足感があまり感じてないのか、どっちかでしょうか。
ムシシのライブアクションに関しては僕は全く関わってないですね。あれは大友克洋さんの監督で全く関わってないんですが、デトロイトメタルシティの映画はアニメとほぼ同時に作ってたので、撮影現場にもお邪魔しましたし、実はカメオで映画の方にも出てますし。
He said that for the Mushishi, he actually had nothing to do with it at all. So that was all Otomo Katsuhiro-san that was in charge of that. However, with the one that Detroit Metal City, that was actually being made at the same time as the anime. And so a lot of times he would go on set and kind of see what was going on with that. And he said that he even actually had a cameo in the live action. So it was very intertwined with those two. Yeah.
You're currently promoting a series here at Ronin Expo called The Reflection. How did you end up working with prolific writer Stan Lee? And now that, with the unfortunate passing of Stan Lee, where does the series stand?
これはリフレクションのアニメシリーズのことについてなんですけれども、どうやってそのやっぱり神様であるあのスタン・リーさんと一緒に共演できるようになったのか、何がきっかけだったのか、あとはこれからやっぱりスタン・リーさんがもうお亡くなりになったということはこの先はどうなるのかという質問です。
あのきっかけはもう自分が昔からアメリカンコミックやアメリカの、まあ、おもちゃとかそういうものが大好き でそのことをずっと言い続けてたんですね。アメリカ大好きだ、アメリカンコミック大好きだ。そしたらアメリカにいるプロデューサーさんが、あ、じゃ あのアメリカに来るかいとか、あのアメリカで仕事やってみるとかで、アメコミ好きだったんだったらスタンに会いに行こうかとか言って、本当にあの好きだ好きだって言い続けたら人が引き合わせてくれたっていうのが今回の、まあ、本当のことですね。
So he's always been super influenced by and loved US comics, which of course includes all Stanley's work. Like he loves the Marvel world. And he's always told everyone, I love the way the US does comics, I love the toys, I love everything. And one day one of his US producer friends said, why don't you come to the States? You want to work in the States? And maybe he's like, I'll go introduce you to Stan Lee. And he was like, oh, okay. Sure. And so he went and met Stan Lee. That was around 2005. Yeah.
で、スタンが亡くなってリフレクションはじゃあどうなるのかって質問でしたけど、もうスタンが存命の時にこの先のストーリーっていうのはある程度アイデアを出していて、全然それのほんの一部しか今回のシリーズではあのアニメができなかったんですね。だからこれからはスタンと打ち合わせをした残りのリフレクションのストーリーをアニメーションにまたする、またね、アニメーションにして放送して皆さんに見ていただく機会が設けられたらなと思ってます。
And even though, you know, you're asking about the future of the series, so he said that he actually went over a lot of the ideas, the concepts, the storyline with Stan Lee while he was still alive. So...Only a little bit of what they had discussed and what they had planned is actually featured in the anime. And so he wants to go ahead and continue telling the story with all this material that both him and Stan came up with when he was still alive, and continue to and use the anime series and bring out, he said that he feels like he has, you know, another season that he can bring all that coming into fruition.
The reflection, the shocking answer awaits you here.
Now, for those who don't know about the reflection, can you give us a brief elaborate on what the reflection is about without giving out any major spoilers?
そうですね。あの、ある日、世界中をこうリフレクションと呼ばれる現象が襲うんですね。それは空を緑色の光がバーッとこう地球上の空を駆け巡っていくっていう現象なんですけど、その光に当たったものは特殊能力を得てしまうんですよ。
So all one day all around the world there was a green light that's in the sky. It's just and people that are touched by that green light get superpowers.
実はそのまあ、キラキラと光るからリフレクションって名付けられたんですけど、それはみんな光しか見えてなかったからそのリフレクションと名付けられたんですが、実はその緑色の光っていうのは最初に黒い煙が出ていて、その黒い煙を打ち消すために緑色の光が起こってるんですよ。でも人々はそれに気づくのが遅れてしまうんですけど、だからキラキラという光だけを見てリフレクションって言った。でも本当は煙が最初にあって、それをこう光がパチパチパチパチと消してるんですよ。でそれが実は地上に降り注いでくるんですけど、光が当たったものはその多くのものがスーパーヒーローのようなキャラクターになり、煙も当たった人間がいて、煙の影響を受けた普通の人間は醜く変形したり、そのヴィランのようなスーパーヴィランのようなキャラクターになっていたっていうのが実は
Interesting.
Okay. So everyone all around the world, they see this green light in the sky, right? Which is actually that kirike, it's like the shining, which is where the whole the reflection comes into play, like the title. But actually what a lot of people don't really see at the very beginning is there's black smoke that comes first, and then to dissipate that, the green light appears. And this is when the green will touch certain people and then give them superpowers. The black will touch certain people and then give them villain powers, or like make them like hard to see, or like very ugly. Like, you know, it'll kind of give the, make the worst of people.
Now, this is questions and addendum to what I asked earlier about the live action movies. With live action, anime adaptations being made here in live action in the United States, how do you feel that the United States is actually taking anime or live action productions made in Japan and making them a sort of, for lack of a better term, Americanized?
So Detective Pikachu and like stuff like
Dragon
that
is Evolution, Sonic the Hedgehog.
Yeah. So 結構最近やっぱりアメリカってまあハリウッドは特にやっぱりそういうトレンドじゃないですか。傾向でやっぱりそういうまあピカチュウでもそうなんだけど、まあいろんなあの日本のアニメのコンテンツまたは日本のライブアクションをコンテンツをアメリカンっぽくする。そういう傾向についてはどう思いますかって。
そうですね。あの自分は素直に嬉しいですね。うん、日本のコンテンツがあのそうハリウッドで評価されたっていうことの結果がハリウッドでのリメイクだったり実写映画化だと思うので、ああそういう時代が来たんだなって思って自分はすごく嬉しいですね。
He said that quite honestly, like he's just purely excited, not excited, but happy would be the word. Because at the end of the day, like it's imitation is the greatest form of flattery, right? So even though, you know, so the fact that they acknowledge these Japanese properties, whether it be anime manga or live action, and then they do remakes, or they do adaptations, he said he finds it really wonderful and it makes him happy. Yeah, he's like, oh, I guess this is the era that we've come into where there's a lot of this going on.
All right, you guys, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you guys next time.